Do you have a 64 to 73 Mustang? Are you thinking about suspension? Let's talk with the guy who actually designed the coilover system for the front of those cars. Let's check it out.
Yeah.
Hello everyone, we're here in the shop here today and we're talking about our 64 to 73 Mustang front coilover system. Bill here had a major part in designing that kit and we want to look back at the project, the design from start to finish, and understand, I guess, the careful thought consideration that goes into developing a product like that. So Bill, thanks for being with us for one.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess, give us a background, give us an understanding. When we started with this project and we said, hey Bill, you got this car, we got these parts, how do we make a kit work? What were some of the initial jumping off points for you?
We set out to design a suspension kit or a shock and spring kit that replaced the factory pieces. It simplified the factory setup. It was easy to install and mm-hmm. it didn't require any modifications, any like permanent modifications, i.e. cutting, drilling, welding, anything like that.
At face value, that seems like a tough ask.
It can be, but you know, this is what we do.
Right. So that's great. So we kind of set out, those are kind of like problem statements, if you
yep.
will, right? Mm-hmm. So ride height adjustability, that's something that's super important. I can't speak to that enough, how getting the perfect stance makes or breaks a car.
Because you can have a car that has the perfect set of wheels, but if it's sitting way off of them, it looks stupid.
Yeah, or if it leans to one side, or whatever the issue may be, or just whatever your personal preference is. Because you know what? There are some of those traditional ride heights that I think just look great. It's very, on par with the heritage of the car. Other times, just slammed in the weeds, super low. I like that a ton too,
yeah.
Right? But those two things can be a tall ask when you say, but it's got to ride great too.
Yeah.
Because ride quality, whether you're going to the grocery store, if you're on Hot Rod Power Tour or anywhere in between, makes or breaks your whole experience.
Yeah. Bad ride quality will really make you question why you have the vehicle.
Right.
And that's something, you know, a 50-year-old or heck, even, you know, if you got a 64 Mustang, you're closer to 60 years
That's
old
right.
than you are 50. A lot of that stuff never got serviced. It just
right.
didn't, because they were kind of throwaway cars when they were originally made. They didn't think necessarily that people were going to be still driving these things in 60, 70 years. Well, so, and then what happened, and especially in the case of the Mustangs, they have what's called a loaded upper control arm, which puts the shock and the spring on the upper control arm rather than the lower.
Right.
And in that, they designed this rocker system that the spring and the shock goes on, so that as the control arm goes up and down, this rocker is kind of pivoting.
Sure.
In keeping
and
itself.
And readjusting the angle and everything.
Yep. And in that, there's about 1,800 bushings.
No less.
all of which are bad, you know, yep. especially at this point in time. So we wanted something that was going to address that.
And address it in which way? Because you have this, however you want to describe it, whether it's more complex than what it needs to be, but or too many moving parts, but like what specifically did you want to address?
I wanted to get rid of that rocker.
Yeah.
For a couple of reasons. One, that allowed us to get a longer shock in there. A longer shock so that when you do drop it, you're going to have enough travel in both directions. So
sure.
One of our design criteria that we really wanted to meet was, can we lower the car 2 inches and still have adequate shock travel?
Sure. And so that was done by eliminating that bracket, but you did some cool stuff too with the upper bracket as well, where the shock mounts on top. Tell
mm-hmm.
us kind of about that process.
So the upper mount had a kind of a fun little design challenge of, we wanted to make it out of one single piece. In that, I was looking at all of the different cars. There's three basic generations of Mustang within those first 9 years, 64 to 66, 67 to 70, and then 71 to 73. All three of those cars use different upper mounts on the factory shock mount. And that was something that we needed to consider, we needed to look at, and I had to go in and figure out why are they different, especially the 64 to 66 mount is nearly identical to the 67 to 70 mount, but the 67 to 70 mount is shorter. So I was like, well, why the heck did they do that? Because they use the same shock. If you look up any, even our catalog Stalker Star shock is the same shock from 64 up to 70. But they use that different mount. So I'm like, well, what the heck's going on there? So we had to get every version of those cars in and took a whole bunch of measurements and went, oh, they raised the shock tower in 67. So they made a change in 67. They raised the shock tower by about an inch,
okay,
which meant that that mount was an inch shorter. So that explained that.
Oh, okay.
So then I'm going, well, wait a minute. So if we use, we didn't want to make a whole bunch of different mounts.
Right.
All three of those mounts use the same footprint, the same bolt pattern to mount to the car. They're just different in how they look.
And with us, you know, if we're speccing out the shock and spring, we don't need to necessarily be handcuffed to those three different mounts any longer.
Right.
Right.
Yep. So what we were able to do is we were able to make it so that we can use the same bracket for the whole run. And when we get to that change, that 67 to 70 change, that was a longer shock. So,
okay.
So we technically have two different kits. There's a kit for 64 to 66, mm-hmm, and then there's a kit from 67 to 73.
Yep.
So it was just a fun little, it was fun to kind of decode what was going on and figure out, like, well, why is this like that, or what did they, and you're kind of looking at the cars through the succession of how they were built and designed.
Well, that's cool, because that's something that I don't think we really touch on a whole lot is, you know, there's the careful consideration, thought, and packaging of how we create a part to have it interact with the vehicle and make the installation experience easy and the parts compatibility easy. But then there's a whole manufacturing side of it on the other side of the wall, essentially from where we are, mm-hmm, that we have to make it work for as well. And it's marrying those two together that can be probably much more of a challenge than what meets the eye.
There's a lot of customers downstream, you know, you got internal customers, you got the people that are going to build the parts and put the parts in boxes and all that.
Right.
They have to know what's going on. You got the customer service customers who have to know the ins and outs of how it's going to fit, what they're going to, you know, what kind of questions they're going to get. And then you've got the real world customers that want to buy the parts and put them on their car. And so there's a lot of people to appease.
Exactly. So we designed the kit. You know, we're into prototyping. We start installing them on the cars. Kind of walk us through, I guess, you know, some of your first impressions when you started taking cars out on the road for the first time with this kit on there. What did that look like?
Our first car that we worked on was a 73 four-speed convertible. It was all stock, fairly worn out, very worn out. And the thing that really jumped out at me was getting the stock stuff out took way longer than getting the new parts back in.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say that, I don't mean that it took a really long time. It's just that the new parts went in really quick. Once you got the old stuff out, you got the old spring out, which is kind of a pain with the spring compressors and all that. Once you get that out, though, the new parts go on in like 15 minutes.
Jeez.
So the installation was that was fun to actually watch it go together and like, holy smokes, that was one of the, that had to have been the easiest coilover install I'd ever done.
So literally you get home on a Friday night, car shows tomorrow morning, boxes at the front door, from the UPS man, and you go running out there, get that installed that night, you're at the car show the next day.
Yeah.
Essentially.
Yeah, if you know what you're doing and you've been in those cars, I would wager to bet that you could get them in the morning and be to the car show at noon, 1 o'clock. I mean, you know, barring like going and getting an alignment and that kind of stuff. But, you know, on this car, just the way it was put together, and everybody kind of talks crap about it, but with the loaded upper control arm is just unconventional, but it makes it, once you get the complicated stuff out of there, i.e. that rocker and everything, it's really easy to work on. I didn't need to split ball joints. Mm. You don't need to take a wheel off if you want to adjust your ride height.
Oh, true.
You can just jack the front end of the car up and you have great access to the, because the shock's up on top.
Yeah.
So just like the, after it's installed, the workability on the kit was really easy.
Sure.
Which we know, I mean, it's not always the most fun part is, you know, like adjusting ride height after you got sway bar and you got brakes and you got all kinds of stuff to contend with. Not in this kit.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic. Now, how about driving impressions? So you know, you talked a little bit about, you know, the car that originally came in here, but whether it be, you know, impressions that you had as, again, the person who had the pleasure of designing it, or feedback you're receiving out there from the field, like what are you seeing? What are you feeling? What are you hearing out there?
Because it removes a lot of that complexity and a lot of those bushings that are most likely bad in your car, it greatly improves ride quality. I mean, you know, I've got about a 20-mile loop around here that works really good for doing test drives and things like that. And there's you know, some like railroad tracks, and I always pay attention to how does the car take the railroad tracks?
Sure.
Do I have to slow way down for them, or can I just hit them at speed? And you know, the first time I had them out there, and I was cruising around in that 73 four-speed car, I was like, I'm not slowing down. I'm just gonna let it do what it's gonna do, and it was like nothing. At those particular tracks, and they, I mean, obviously different tracks, sometimes they're worse than others, but it was just smooth. It let the suspension do what it needed to do without all of the compliance in the rubber bushings or the wore out bad bushings, whatever it is.
So the ride quality is greatly improved. What about like some of the handling characteristics? I mean, the shocks are adjustable. Right.
Shocks are adjustable.
So you can soften them up, you can firm them up. You know, if you have a double adjustable, you can independently tune each direction. What was your impressions, you know, going through some of the winding roads? Because I know the roads you're talking about. Mm-hmm. There are some windy stretches.
Yep. It was a lot of fun. Yeah. It was a lot of fun. Modern shocks, adjustable shocks, that does a lot. Getting shocks that actually have rebound force. you know, in them, things like that. The other thing was spring rate. You know, the factory cars, they use a pretty soft spring. It's very long, which goes back to what makes it difficult to work with.
Sure, understood.
always under tension, or compression rather. So we looked at spring rates. You know, how do we keep the spring rates low enough to maintain comfortable ride, but stiff enough to where like it's gonna feel like a more modern car. So we arrived at 3 spring rates for all 3 different cars. And there's more available if you wanted something outside of that. But it was just a fun project. Going through, looking at the spring rates, figuring out what was gonna work, trying it out, either validated or validated what you thought, or made you go, okay, I gotta crunch some numbers again or something. But it was a fun kit to design.
Well, that's really neat, and it's really gratifying. I mean, the, you know, what things that I'm witnessing, again, we've had this kit out there, you know, all summer long. We have, you know, people writing it into us, whether it be to our tech line with, you know, saying how much they love the kit. We were seeing a bunch of stuff on social media, talking to people at, you know, the shows and stuff that we've been to. It really is one of those kits that checks all the boxes. It's simple, it does what it needs to do, and it does it well. And it solves some of those major problems too. The ride quality, ride height, the things that are really important to a good experience on the road.
Yep.
So hats off to you for a job well done on that. For more information on this kit, make sure to check out QA1.net. Make sure to hit like and subscribe on this video. We got a ton of stuff that comes your way all the time. Check that out. Follow us on social media, and most importantly, go drive it. Hey guys, we're in the shop here today looking at our Bill Foley.
Looking at our Bill Foley.
Here I am.
Hey guys, in the shop here today with Bill Foley, the person who actually led the design efforts on our 64 to 73 front.
That one was me this time.